in bacteria, the genetic transfers and recombination in bacteria. Of course, first one is transfer, the means by which they are transferred to a bacterial cell. Next is recombination. It is combined with the existing chromosomal thing, you know. So transfer and recombination, so both are part of the okay. And we have gone through, of course, in microbial genetics, in some other slide show, we will discuss on the fungal things, you know. Fungi which be in the more evolved organisms, eukaryotes, having specialized means of genetic, you know, like sexual reproduction, in which the there is what you call provision for recombination of the DNA or mixing of the DNA from the two sources which includes the haploidization stage. That's where the gametes are produced, and then recombination to produce zygotes. Is it visible slides?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, the of course, in a sexual reproduction, well-defined sexual reproduction, that is, the reduction division takes place, then the fusion takes place to bring back the original number of the chromosomes. That happens. That is the haploidization during gamete formation stage, then diffusion to leads to the zygote. Of course, from that the new offsprings come out, you know. So, and when the two gametes fuse, the genetic material, there is provision for recombination. However, in bacteria, which are prokaryotes, they lack sexual reproduction, and however, they reproduce through cell fission. Even the division, which is simpler than the cell division which you see with the different phases of cell division. So here simple fission takes place in prokaryotes. And however, in the last 100 years or so, people have discovered three means of these genetic transfers, and in turn the recombination, the provision for recombination of the genetic material was observed in bacteria. The first one was in case of Griffith's experiment, who was working with the pneumococci, Streptococcus pneumoniae, with the two strains. The one strain which was with smooth colonies, the other one with rough colonies, and the rough was less virulent and the smooth was virulent. In mice experiments, with regard to lethality, in the course of experiment, he came to know that when the dead cells of the smooth cells, virulent types, are mixed with live cells of the avirulent R strain, then also it led to the death of the experimental animal mice. Of course, for that he had the things, he thought the thing, transforming factor must be responsible the thing, you know, of course, he was not aware that it is the genetic material, the piece of DNA which was getting in, but he thought some thing, you know, which got into this cell from the dead virulent strains to the live evident strain must be causing this. He called that transformation. That is, you know, the from the environment, that is the thing, you know, from the mixture in the from the surrounding environment, you know, fact, you know, particular thing, you know, he, it got in, caused that thing, you know, bring back, made all of them virulent. So he used the word transformation. And further, of course, the same experiment was thing, you know, conducted in a different way by the other two groups of scientists, and showed that it was the DNA which was responsible, you know, which was getting into the cells, and then they called DNA as the genetic material. That experiment to prove the genetic material, the course of that, you know, some other time, you know, I'll show those two slides, set of slides. And of course, then in a similar way, it was in 1928, then maybe, you know, 20, nearly 18 to 20 years after that, again, Lederberg and in his lab, through his two students, Zinder and his one, and Tatum is another, and they were able to show the thing, you know, like the phenomenon of the, you know, the transduction and the conjugation. We were the first one, transduction by Zinder, Lederberg's one of his students, in the year 1952 it happened, and they showed. And before that, 4 years, you know, before that, the Tatum and, you know, Tatum, Lederberg's another students also showed another means of genetic transfer, that's conjugation. Unlike the previous two case, you know, two cases, transformation, that transduction and conjugation, the thing, you know, physical, you know, effect, you know, like the thing, you know, proximity of the two cells involved in genetic transfer, it is must. It happens where one acts as donor, the other acts as the recipient, and the donor cells, you know, cell possesses like a short bristle tubular thing, you know, structure through which it makes a bridge with the recipient cell, and through that it is able to transfer its genetic material to the next cell. The one which acts as the donor, they called fertility plus. The one which receives fertility minus, F plus and F minus. But here what happens, you know, they showed when from F plus, the thing, you know, after transformation, you know, after conjugation, the F minus, all F minus population gets themselves transformed into F plus type. And here, what is that responsible? This material, you know, of course, it is the thing, you know, which is transferred from the donor cell to the recipient. It can exist in two state, you know, types. One is autonomous state, like in plasmids. So it is, it is an autonomous and independently replicating structure. So independent of that, the chromosomal DNA and, you know, that things, you know, which is transferred. And, you know, of course, even after transferring the cells which receive, it remains separately outside the chromosomal DNA. In some cases, this thing, you know, the sex factor, which is, you know, extra chromosomal state initially, it may become part of the main chromosomal state, you know, by like making covalent, you know, like inserted into the chromosomal DNA covalently, that remains permanently part of the things, you know. So the thing, you know, here what happens, you know, that particular thing is called episome. And here in the first case, F plus and F minus we use. In this case, you know, they have found, scientists have found that the one where the sex factor is, you know, in found part of the chromosomal DNA, the thing, you know, gets integrated, where that recombination is, thing, you know, the very high recombination was seen, and of course in the first case, due to continuous things, you know, it was also, you know, they showed that they used to lose this sex factor in the organisms received after subculturing of them after several generation, you know, they used to lose. So that is, you use the word curing. However, in case of this thing, you know, like where the sex factor is found as part of the main chromosome in the form of episome, they call that, you know, recombination, you know, even after, I think, you know, it was permanently remained in the cells, the recipient cells. That is, they use high frequency recombination, HFR. And for this, what they think is, it is, they think that they are responsible, the insertion sequences. Insertion sequences or IS, insertion sequence, IS elements or insertion sequence, they are also called as transposons, which was first reported by Barbara McClintock in her studies in, you know, in the maize. Maize she showed in the year 1950s, and she received Nobel Prize in the year 1983. It is also called as jumping gene. These insertion sequences is that they can move along the, you know, genomic DNA anywhere and get themselves attached or combined. So that's the specialty of them. That is due to the presence of an enzyme called transposase. And based on the things, you know, whether they have only this particular parameter or addition other things, you know, they be in the course of study, of course, later years, people have found that in these insertion sequences or transposons, there are two kinds. The first kind, they are only simple ones, simple insertion sequences, where they possess only the, you know, thing in an enzyme, the information for the enzyme that is required for their insertion into the genomic DNA. So they code only for a protein that is implicated for transposition activity, that is the enzyme transposase. So only they are very simple. They are about 700 to 2500 base pairs. The next category of our composite transposons, the simple transposons and composite transposons. In case of composite transposons, in addition to their ability to produce the enzyme responsible for transposition activity, the thing, you know, transposase, they do carry some of the, you know, informations, you know, responsible for drug resistance, then many things, you know, many informations they showed on the flanking either side of the arms of this thing, you know, transposing element. The flanking arms, you we call on either side, the center, you have the thing, you know, main gene responsible for the production of the transposase enzyme. On either side, the things in information, they are known to carry additional information responsible for other factors, including drug resistance and other things. So they are called as composite.
Sir.
So they are called as composite transposons. So like that, we have come, you know, like the different three means of genetic transfers and recombinations that are seen, though they lack sexual reproduction, bacteria are known to possess not to possess these three means, transmission, transduction and conjugation. Three means, of course, these three principles have, or phenomenons have been widely used in genetic recombination. That's where people, of course, you have seen, number thousands of experiments wherein a particular specific gene containing the novel information, it is cloned into a vector, then in turn it is transferred into the host, making it having specific character, the character target organism. It is called as transgenic organism. Transgenic, it is seen in case of microorganisms, transgenic microorganisms or transgenic plants or transgenic elements. Many examples we have seen in recent years. So they have created things, and of course in edible plants, of course you have seen for example BT corn and BT brinjal, all that. And in economic crop, BT, cotton and other things you have seen. Like that, of course, so many thousands of experiments will come across. And this particular thing, it is called as the recombinant DNA technology or the genetic engineering. Here, what they do is, of course, they make use of the, what are known as the vectors, molecular vectors, they make use, of course, like plasmids, cosmids, phagmids, and other, even bacteriophages, and the other kinds of things, which are capable of carrying information, the inserted information into them to the target organism. That is the thing. So they are used as vectors, the one, which is carrier material, carrier molecule. And another thing is, here also we make use of the things called as which are very important. They play an important role. They are restriction enzymes. We will just briefly go through these two things, molecular vectors and the things, in the next few slides, we'll go through the molecular. First one is the molecular vectors, the one, which are helpful in carrying the information. So what are these vectors? Vectors, the cloning are, of course, they are usually called as cloning vectors or molecular vectors, which are actually, the one, which are useful for carrying the information which are inserted to them. And of course, a cloning vector is a small piece of DNA, which may be a circular molecule or a linear molecule, taken from a virus, a plasmid, or from the other cells of a higher organism, that can be stably maintained in an organism and into which a foreign DNA fragment can be inserted for cloning purpose. So that's the thing. So cloning, you mean, insertion, cloning. So these vectors, which are used generally, of course, it started with the studies of in 1973, early 70s, the work of Cohen and Boyer, of course, which came out with a thing, the first recombinant things, they created, recombinant vector they created E. coli experimental organism, E. coli, for which they were awarded with the thing, the Nobel Prize. And they, of course, in general, the molecular vectors which are used in the biotechnology or molecular biology studies, they are of two types. First one is cloning vectors. These are the vectors, molecules which are used simply to amplify the DNA fragment which is inserted to them. And here, they are used only for the amplification of the DNA material. Amplification of the DNA material, they are used d DNA material. Of course, here DNA material is inserted into the vector plasmid, and then it is, in turn transformed into E. coli cell. Usually, in the molecular biology studies, it is among the bacteria, it is the Escherichia coli, which is very widely used compared to other organisms because it is easily culturable and easily amenable for all studies. Molecular, I think, that E. coli has been the widely used organism. And another thing is, in cloning vectors, what they need is, these vectors need the information, the ORI site, origin of replication alone. Origin of replication alone. And only the thing, they should facilitate the replication of the DNA. So that's the only thing, of course, in this case, we have several plasmids, bacteriophages, cosmids, and yeast artificial chromosomes, bacterial artificial chromosomes, all of them we have. And the next thing is expression vectors, where they differ. In contrast to the cloning vectors, where they facilitate only the doubling of the DNA, amplification of the DNA, the expression vectors, they have additional characters. In the sense, they have a thing, called of course you are aware in central dogma where the genetic information is transformed from DNA to RNA, RNA to protein, which is a the transduction of the information. In this case, the main molecule, intermediary molecule that plays a important role is, it is RNA. So on a piece of DNA, that is you call gene, the mRNA is synthesized. And in this case, the mRNA synthesis, the RNA polymerase enzyme, which is responsible for the synthesis of the mRNA, it is known to attach at a place of, from a zero point, that is the, you call downstream and upstream. Downstream, upstream of the, the start point is a thing called promoter site. So these expression vectors, they have a thing in a place where this RNA polymerase can bind. In addition to the thing in a place for the restriction sites for different enzymes, that particular thing. So expression vectors, only advantage is, like in case of cloning vector, the product remains only DNA. It is amplified. Whereas in expression vector, from DNA, the information go to RNA, and then ultimately it leads to the production of a end product, protein product. That's the information. In all recombinant, genetic engineering studies, the important thing is your experiment should reach the end product. Should be able to reach the end product. And of course, cloning procedure, of course, in all these things, in genetic engineering, it takes fragmentation, ligation, that is diffusion, insertion of the gene of interest into the vector molecule, then transfection, that is transforming it to the target organ. So usually it is the Escherichia E. coli, which is used in the lab. And the next thing is screening and selection. Of course, it is done. Screening and selection, it is done differently in different cloning vectors and expression vectors. In cloning vector, you will just see the accumulation of the DNA, the amplification of the DNA, how much DNA you are able to get at the end of that multiplication. In expression vectors, you will look into the protein product. And of course, this shows the different procedure, like the protocols involved in that. And the characteristics of a cloning vectors, all that, of course, what it should have, of course, it should be autonomously replicating. So it should be able to replicate autonomously. That's the first point. Second point is very, very important. I have told you, it should have an origin of replication. You use the word ORI site. You call it as ORI site. And then you should also carry selectable markers for different things. like antibiotic resistance and other things. You know, various things are used, illumination, you know, light illumination genes and so on. Then the next thing is they should also carry, they should of course self-replication and multiple copies of that they should be able to produce. They should have restriction sites, very important, you know, restriction sites for cleaving them with the help of an enzyme, restriction enzyme. That is where your gene of interest is inserted, you call cloning site. And they should be smaller in size. Otherwise what happens, you know, you will not be able to insert it into the, you know, like experimental organism like E. coli cell. If they are very large, you may not be, you fail to insert it into E. coli cell. It's possible. So as far as possible, you know, one side they should be smaller. At the same time, they should be able to carry, you know, larger, you know, your interest to insert a lengthy piece of the DNA. And of course, they should be lower molecular weight they should have. And of course, no pathogenicity is should be associated with them. In any case, it should not lead to health complications. Then easily isolated and purified. Of course, we have different things, you know, the plasmid isolation and things in a protocols in the lab, you know, we have easily isolated into host cell, transformed into inserted into host cell, you know, that's the things, you know, we have protocols like heat shock method and other, you know, liposuction and so many protocols are there, 10-15 different protocols. And then control elements, here promoter, operator, ribosome binding site, all these things matters only in case of expression vectors. In cloning vectors, they are not present. Only replication or site. What they do is vectors, there are different kinds, plasmids, bacteriophages, phosmids, yeast cloning vectors, and of course the naturally occurring ones in nature. We have the Agrobacterium tumefaciens, Agrobacterium radiobacter, so rhizogenes mediated things, you know, where you have the things called naturally occurring plus, you know, these things called vectors called TI plasmids and RI plasmids. So the things, you know, of course plasmids, they are used mainly in bacterial transformations, and bacteriophages, of course, bacteria. Cosmids are also used for cosmids, they are the, you know, combination of the plasmid along with the cohesive site taken from the bacteriophage lambda, so that the assembly becomes very easy. Then yeast cloning vectors, the information here, it involves takes the information from the plasmid vector, and it uses of course the information derived from yeast with respect to promoter and replication and different things. They are taken from yeast. Of course, it is mainly used in case of yeast. Then you have the TI and RI plasmids. TI and RI plasmids, of course, the transformation of cloned genes in higher plants, it is used. And of course, here the first one, you know, the plasmid. The first among them is the plasmid. You are aware, plasmid is an extra chromosomal, you know, like a circular genetic, you know, the circular, you know, material, which is autonomously replicate, you know, it is capable of autonomously replicating. The examples to start with, we have these two, PBR322 and PUC18. They were first thing, you know. And here we're more, you know, POC or PBR, what is that? You know, people will be curious about that. The P, small letter, it is usually in small letter, it stands for the plasmid. Then BR, in the first case, BR, it stands for the two scientists who have worked with it, Bolivar and Rodriguez, who are responsible for discovery of this plasmid. Prasmatam 322, of course, this also, it lies with the experimental, maybe, you know, the numbers or the cloning, you know, recombination factors and all that, you know, they are going to take. In the second case, PUC18, of course, in contrast to the first one, here P stands for plasmid, you see the university from which it came, you know, the University of California, PUC, and 18, of course, it carries, of course, the information of, that's how they, you know, you come across different, plasmid vectors that are used. And of course, plasmid vectors, as I told you, they are extra chromosomal things, you know, which are self-replicating. In while talking about plasmids, they are autonomous with respect to replication and which can transfer genes from one cell to another cell. That is, they can get transfused into the cell in target organism. That's what the Frederick, Griffith, he showed, you know. Of course, he was not aware the DNA which can get into the cell from the surrounding environment. It may be a piece of DNA or the vector carrying the fused DNA, you call recombinant vector. Okay. And in this case, while talking about plasmids, you have two kinds, you know. You must have already studied it in PUC. That is the thing, you know, like you have the relaxed plasmids, and the relaxed plasmids means the plasmids where, you know, their more number of copies are found. The other one is stringent plasmid, where only few number of these plasmid numbers are found. While selecting plasmids, you know, after their discovery, people usually prefer to have the plasmids which can, you know, like produce more number of plasmid copies in a bacterial cell, because, you know, for replication of the DNA, amplification of the DNA, they are more useful. Of course, these plasmids they carry, they contain origin of replication, allowing for the replication of the gene, things independent of that of host genome, contain selective markers for the selection of the cells containing plasmids, like usually antibiotic resistant, tetracycline resistant, amphicycline resistance, kanamycin resistance, like that. When we are working in the lab, you know, we make use of that particular thing. We, you know, like grow these things, you know, in the presence of that antibiotic, containing the media, we will grow. In case if the organism grows in that, that means to say it is carrying that gene which is resistant to that particular thing. That is more than that, MCS site, multiple cloning site. This is very, very important. A stretch on the circular plasmid, you find a thing called MCS. MCS, where you have, you know, the restriction sites for different enzymes, where you can cut that particular thing with the thing, you know, a restriction enzyme, and which here only thing is that restriction enzyme should be able to cut that particular phosphate. At the same time, it should also make the similar cuts on the thing, you know, DNA piece of interest. So thereby the thing, you know, insertion becomes possible. So is it to be isolated from the host cell? That's what we have the protocols for plasmid isolation techniques, and the same two examples, PUC or PBR, you can take as examples. And in the plasmids, of course, generally you come across, already we have discussed in conjugation, fertility plasmids, which are capable of conjugation and result in the expression of sex pili. Then resistant plasmids. They contain genes that provide resistance against antibiotics and poisons and so on. In nature, many organisms are known to have plasmids which are meant for that. You know, for example, pesticide degradation or plastic degradation or oil degradation or some antibiotic resistance and so on. All that, you know, people have isolated them. Then coal plasmids, they contain genes that code for bacteriocins proteins that can kill other bacteria. So the, you know, the products known as bacteriocins, you know, these plasmids, they contain such information. Then degradative plasmids, I have already told you, there it is, resistance, here it is, you know, they, what you call, import ability to the host bacterium carrying this plasmid to degrade specific substances, like, for example, salicylic acid, toluene, or in case of the Pseudomonas, you know, oil, what you call, crude oil, things, you know, oil spill, toluene problem, the organism should be able to degrade that oil, you know, that's the thing. Then virulence plasmids. So here, the presence of these plasmids make a bacterium carrying them highly virulent. Of course, this is the things, you know, pictorial representation of these two things, you know, kindly, it will be with you, go through all that information. Multiplication of the plasmids, how it happens. When it is inserted into E. coli cell, usually when the cell multiplies, along with that, it, you know, cell multiplies, of course, it multiplies within the cell. These plasmids, they multiply and attain maximum numbers. Of course, that's what I have told you. Usually we prefer relaxed plasmids. Well, you know, like transforming that particular plasmid, we may make cuts in that plasmid and introduce a new gene of interest, a DNA fragment to be cloned. It is cloned. That is called as recombinant plasmid. You call, you see, this is initially, it is only the plasmid. Then to that, the DNA of interest is introduced. We use the word recombinant plasmid. Then when it is inserted into the things, you know, we call transformation, you know, into the E. coli cell. In the E. coli cell, it is made into, you know, large number of copies of that. Of course, the interests are given, all that. So the various interests, of course, other than the genetic engineering, making use of these plasmids in the DNA amplification, or the plasmids which are expression plasmids for genetic engineering, they are also have other uses, you know, they are used for other purposes. The advantages and disadvantages. Advantages, of course, they are very useful because they being the smaller molecules and autonomously replicating and carry information for drug resistance, especially antibiotic resistance and all, handling them becomes very easy, and they are very useful tools in the genetic engineering protocol. And of course, only drawback is that, you know, because they are very small by nature, their size, it is maximum size is up to 10 kilo base pairs, that is 10,000 base pairs, up to that they will have. So they, of course, their total size, in that you should imagine the to what extent their thing can be taken out and insert a piece, about 1,500 base pairs, you know, maximum, you know, you can insert. You can't expect to insert a very large piece of the things, you know, when the plasmid size itself, maximum size is 10 kilo base, that is 10,000 base pairs length. Then the next is, of course, bacteriophage vector, the second in the list. Of course, in that, the lambda phage we have studied as an example for a virulent strain, you know. Virulent things, you know, for the things, you know, which type we and the other one, T series, they are associated with the lytic bacteriophages, and this lambda series, lambda, it is associated with it is lysogenic bacteriophages, which are responsible for transduction. Then there is one thing called M13 bacteriophage, which is a single stranded linear bacteriophage, but which can also covalently bind to form a circular thing. Of course, the I know the thing, you know, it shows the different things of the lambda phage. You know, of course, only advantage in case of bacteriophage mediated genetic transfer is, so like the size of the piece, you can increase in the size of the piece. You can aim for little larger piece of the DNA. You can increase, you know, as compared to the plasmids. And of course, the you know, packaging is also becomes very easy. So only disadvantage, it has narrow host range. It can't infect the bacteria beyond that its host range. That's the only drawback. Otherwise, it is useful. Of course, M13 bacteriophage in you know, as a as an alternative to lambda bacteriophage, it is also used in studies. And you know, like of course, it has its own applications. Then after you know, plasmids and after bacteriophages, the next thing, of course, it is artificially derived by, you know, created by molecular biologists by combining part of the lambda chromosome with part of the plasmids. So here, what it contains? It contains cos site from the lambda bacteriophage. Cos site is associated with packaging, and then plasmid origin of replication. Origin of replication from the plasmids and the cos site meant for packaging of the DNA into it. It is like it comes from, you know, the lambda bacteriophage. So by combining both the parameters, you know, things that they have created cosmids, you know, the combination of the lambda you know, character with the plasmid characters. Different series are there in this cosmids. Similarly, phagmid is also there, where it is derived from M13, called phagmid. And structure of the cosmid, origin of replication, of course, they have restriction sites. Similar to that, they have selectable marker, they have the plasmid. And cos site, this is very important, a sequence yield cohesive end, with cohesive end, which is, you know, like very easy for you to pack, you know, for packaging, it is important, so it carries that particular thing. Next thing, all that, you know, so the diagrammatic things, you know, the application, uses of cosmids, of course, you know, first stands plasmids, shorter fragment, and the bacteriophages, little larger fragment, then in cosmids, I know little more larger fragments can be put into it because it carries the cohesive end cos site from the lambda bacteriophage. And of course, it is used, these cosmids are used. ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ಲಿ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ಇದೆಯನ್ನ ನೋಡಿ ಗಮನಿಸಿದ್ದೇಶ್ And the cosmids, of course, I know it is possible to insert larger fragments of the DNA. Usually, these cosmids are used to establish gene libraries of lower and higher organisms. In gene libraries, you have two kinds of genes: genomic library. You have a thing called genomic library. The other one is, that is expression library. Then gene cloning through cosmid helps in the study of nonsense sequence in the genome. Of course, all that, you know, various parameters which are, you know, Next, of course, fudge made. Only difference is it, you know, instead of lambda, it has the information from the thing, you know, like M13 bacteriophage, not lambda bacteriophage. Then artificial chromosomes. Artificial chromosomes, you have three types. Here in the down, you can see in this slide, yolk, back, then, you know, all that, yolk and so on. So that is yeast artificial chromosome, bacterial artificial chromosome, bacterial artificial chromosome. Then you have P1 derived artificial chromosome, mammalian artificial chromosome, human artificial chromosome, and so on, which are actually constructed in the molecular biology labs, constructed in the molecular biology labs for molecular biology, in molecular biologists for different things, you know, targeted works. Targeted works. So they, of course, these are all artificial. Then, of course, what they have, their advantages and all that is the artificial chromosome, bacterial artificial chromosome. Then you have human artificial chromosomes. All that, you know, of course, they are used for specific purposes. Then you have what are known as among the, you know, like vectors that are used. One class of vectors, they are called as shuttle vectors. Shuttle vectors. In DNA, recombinant DNA technology, one main drawback is that, of course, you have the cellular organization, two types, you know, the prokaryotes and eukaryotes. The thing, you know, which works in a bacterium may not work in a eukaryotic system. That's why they created molecular biologists another class of vectors called shuttle vectors, which are they are the vectors that can shuttle between more than one host, for example, from E. coli cell and to yeast cells, or E. coli, you know, so, you know, like that, that is from prokaryote to eukaryotic cells, you know, that particular thing, you know, they are called as shuttle vectors, which can work both in a prokaryotic system as well as eukaryotic system. There are some, you know, some of the things, you know, that are given. This is very important. Like all summarized things, you know, starting from plasmids, then bacteriophage, then phosmid, then bacterial artificial chromosome, yeast artificial chromosome, mammalian artificial chromosome. What are all the their thing, you know, like things, you know, their limits, you know, basis, then the size, you know, how, to what extent. In case of plasmids, only 10 kilobase can be things, you know. So there, of course, where in a mammalian it goes up to 100 kilobase or 1 mega, base pair length. So that's the things, you know. Of course, as the need increases, the things, of course, the demand increases, then, of course, the people started creating things to meet that demand. Lastly, the other class of things, you know, which are naturally occurring, which are made use in genetic engineering, they are agrobacterium mediated genetic transfers. The agrobacterium, you are aware, in agrobacterium, which is a pathogenic bacterium, it has two species in that, of course, the infectious species, agrobacterium tumefaciens, which causes clone wall. Another one, agrobacterium rhizogenes, which causes hairy root disease. Both of them, they, you know, in agrobacterium tumefaciens, a plasmid is responsible for this infectivity, that is TI plasmid. Whereas in, you know, rhizogenes, RI plasmid, which is responsible for introducing that hairiness, hairy roots, root disease in them. And the speciality of these two, agrobacterium mediator, whether it's TI plasmid or RI plasmid, you know, here the thing is, you know, complete, you know, permanent integration of the characters which you introduce into a plant cell So they are very efficient in introducing, as compared to other systems, the plasmids or other ones. These are very useful, especially for manipulation of the, you know, working with the plants. Agriculturally important plants, they are very useful. And here what it is given, TI, what are TI plasmids and how they look like, RI plasmids and what they do, and how these agrobacterium, whether it is tumefaciens or rhizogenes with TI or RI plasmids, how they are used to introduce gene of interest to the things, you know, the target plants. But only, you know, they have certain limitations. They are extensively used in dicots, but much more difficulty to obtain the same results in monocots, where infectivity is seen only in the dicots. Of course, monocots, so they are less infective. Naturally also, the this agrobacterium town gall disease and all that, it is seen only dicotyledonous plants. But yet, eventually, artificial techniques for achieving T DNA transfer in monocots were also devised. Of course, it is improved. Then ease of recovery plants varies with species. And of course, species to species, it varies. Hence, gene gun technique is being used. Of course, by using this TI plasmid, by using gene gun technique, you know, where the things are introduced directly, they're shot, the plant tissues are shot to introduce this agrobacterium containing things, you know, recombinant things into the host cells. So that there is, you know, that particular thing is also used. So we will continue in the next class. We'll continue in the next class. The next restriction enzymes, in the remaining portion, we will complete the mutation and all that, you know, we will complete in the next class. So we'll stop at this juncture. So kindly send the information. Thank you all. So the
thank you, sir.
Thank you, isn't it there? 92, na?
No,
I said 92 either, sir. Ayitu idu maadi first ella konege yen madana ante helidre 1 by 1 ondande chapter the question kurta hogtini kutkondo dictate martini ni avaga tagondo adna idu matta hogbodu adike idu bega idu madana practical do adu mugiskobeku iga biochemical reactions ide inu more series ide matte idu factors affecting ide general ide ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಇನ್ನೇನು ಇದ್ ಮಾಡಿ
ಸರ್ ಅದು ಮಿಡ್ ಟರ್ಮ್ ಕೇಳ್ತೀನಿ ಅಂದಿದ್ರು ಕೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಸರ್
ಇವಾಗ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಡೇ ಬೈ ಡೇ ವಿಪರೀತ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆಗ್ತಿದೆಯಲ್ಲ ನೋಡಿ ಸುಮ್ಮನೆ ನೆಗ್ಲೆಕ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಗೌರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಇವಾಗ ನೋಡಿ ಲಾಕ್ಡೌನ್ ಹೋಗಿದ್ದಾರೆ ತುಂಬಾ ಡೆತ್ ರೇಟ್ಸ್ ಇದೆ ಎಲ್ಲಾ ಕಡೆ ಆಲ್ ಓವರ್ ದಿ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ ಅದು ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಲ್ಲಿ ವಿಪರೀತ ಹೈ ಇದೆ ಇದೆ ಬಟ್ ಇವಾಗ ಎಲ್ಲಿ ಲಾಕ್ ಡೌನ್ ತೆಗೆದ್ರು ಮತ್ತೆ ಅದು ಬೇರೆ ಕೋವಿಡ್ ಸೆಂಟ್ರಿಗೆ ತಗೊಂಡ್ಬಿಟ್ಟಾರೆ ಹಾಸ್ಟೆಲ್ ಹುಡುಗರನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ಗರ್ಲ್ಸ್ ಬಾಯ್ಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಇವೆ ವೆಕೇಟ್ ಮಾಡಿಸ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಈಗ ತಗೊಂಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಕೋವಿಡ್ ಸೆಂಟ್ರಿಗೆ ತಗೊಂಡಿದ್ರೆ ಇನಾಗ್ರೇಟಿವ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ ನಿನ್ನೆ ಮೊನ್ನೆ ಯಾವಾಗ ಮಾಡ್ಯವ್ರೆ
ಅದು
ಅದೇ ಅಲ್ವಾ ಫೋಟೋನು ಬಂದದೆ
ಅದಕ್ಕೆ
ನೋಡೋಣ ಅದು ಏನ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ ನೋಡೋಣ So, ellaru matte once again, all of you should be very careful. Don't go anywhere, you know, outside. Try to confine yourself to your homes.
Okay.
Careful, sir. I agree.
Okay,
thank you, sir. Vaccination, everybody. Register mercy vaccination. Give up one day. Vaccination will be given to 18 to 45 only for those who have registered at the officially. ಅದೇನ ಪ್ರೊಸೀಜರ್ ಇರುತ್ತೆ ನೋಡಿ ಆನ್ಲೈನ್ ಇದ್ ಮಾಡಿ ರಿಜಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಮಾಡಿಸ್ರಿ
ಓಕೆ ಸರ್
ಓಕೆ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಆಲ್
ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಸರ್
ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು
ಸರ್
ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು
ಬಾಯ್
ಎಲ್ಲ ಮೊಬೈಲ್